First of all, a warm welcome, because the purpose of this current affairs class is to give you that extra one mark in every question. There are two important points which you have to understand first when you write a main examination. Whether it is general studies or it is optional, there are two points which you have to remember. You have to apply as well. Number one, the answer should contain only simple statements. The answer should contain only simple statements. Simple statement does not mean that you write in your own language. Simple statement means a sentence shall not be more than two lines, because it will not be interesting for the examiner to read non-stop what you are writing, first of all. Secondly, when you write a very lengthy sentence, sometimes we may end up refuting our own statement. What we have made in the first few lines, we will totally refute in the 10th line or 15th line if you don't break the sentence. So, it has to be very simple, it has to be very short, it has to be very sweet as well. And the second important criterion which you have to apply when you write a main answer is, the answer should be contemporaneous. These two are very, very simple basic rules you have to follow. Contemporaneous means, you know, that it has to have something which is related to the current affairs. So, the purpose of this session is to help you in this aspect. Write an answer which is very contemporaneous. If you could incorporate, if you could incorporate the current affairs in your answer, then you are telling to the examiner that you have understood the subject, because otherwise it is not possible. Only a person who has understood the subject can only integrate current affairs with the subject. So, you are telling the examiner that I have understood the subject, and you have understood the subject means definitely is going to give you the reward. So, these two simple rules you have to practice. Knowing is not important, applying this is very important. You start applying in the test batch. You are writing the test, no, you start applying in the test batch. And this rule is not just applicable to sociology, it is applicable to any optional. And it is applicable to even general studies. It is applicable to even essay. Because two things, simple, contemporaneous. We have already spoken more than 120 topics we have already taken in the current affairs sociology class, which is there in the YouTube channel. It is there in the form of 6 videos, 100 plus topics we have covered. The origin of this class will have to be traced to 2017, I think 2017, yes. 2017 main examination, some students taking up mains examination were asking me, can I give an orientation regarding how to incorporate current affairs in sociology, and that was culminating in the form of a class. In that class, close to 27 topics I have taken, and I could visibly see the difference, because the students who have written these topics in their answers, they have found their paper 2 scores going up. So, which means that there is a high possibility of what we are taking in the current affairs sociology class to come exactly in the paper 2. Because the paper 1 is about theory, paper 2 is application of the theory. Application of the theory is only coming in the form of current affairs sociology. So, this is the brief introduction about the history of this current affairs sociology class. Now, what I have planned for today's class is, I will take up some 12 to 13 topics, which is very, very important from the UPSC sociology syllabus point of view. Always, when you read the current affairs, you shall have your syllabus paper, sociology syllabus paper by side. Beside that newspaper, there should be sociology syllabus paper. You have to superimpose the syllabus paper onto the newspaper to find out which is important from sociology point of view, which is not important. So, syllabus gives you the filter with the help of which you can filter the newspaper. And it is ideal that don't have the syllabus paper by your side, you have syllabus paper in your mind. You memorize the syllabus paper. Anytime you should be able to tell this topic means 8th unit, paper 1, this topic means section B, 3rd unit, this topic means section C, paper 2, 7th unit, social transformation challenges. So, like that you should be able to link. And most of you also know that in the Telegram channel of us, we are daily basis, we are uploading the sociology related articles coming in various newspapers. Those who have not subscribed the Telegram channel, kindly subscribe the Telegram channel, because daily basis we are giving you. If you could make a notes of all those things which we are giving, in fact, we are not giving just like that. We are highlighting what has to be written by you, what has to be recorded by you, what has to be registered in your mind. Just the highlighted portions if you can retain, nothing like that, right? So, this is apart from the class, and the plan is that every fortnightly we'll have some class like this to help you integrate what you are reading in the newspaper with your sociology answers. Actually, the purpose is very, very simple. The goal is very, very simple. What others are doing, that you should not do. You should do something other than what they are doing. In a competitive examination, it is about relative performance. What others are doing, extra what you are doing. So, ordinary, extraordinary, the distinction is only based on this. What extra you are doing, because of which the extra scores you will get. 1 mark extra, half a mark extra. If you get half a mark extra in each question, sociology paper 1, paper 2 put together, you will get 20 marks extra. Half a mark extra in one question, you will get 20 marks extra. 1 mark extra in one question, you can get 30 to 40 marks extra, and that will take up you to another level. Understood. So, each and every mark, a single mark, half a mark, quarter mark, you have to work on that. Otherwise, we will not be able to get the reward. Only the pain which you are experiencing will translate into gain, and that cannot happen overnight. It will have to happen after systematically preparing this thing for a quite longer period of time till your mains is completed by 2020. Right? Now, let us take the first topic, which is a very, very burning topic, called as NRC. What is sociology of NRC? The concept of citizenship is present in unit number 7 of paper 1, as well as polity and society of paper 2. So, there is a concept called as citizenship. We are taking up the first topic, sociology of NRC. What is sociology? You have read the politics of NRC. Now, we will discuss the sociology of NRC. What is sociology behind NRC? I have told you polity and society is the topic in syllabus of sociology, in which you have the concept called as citizenship, democracy. Democracy and citizenship are the two sides of the same coin. Without this, there is no this. There is no citizenship without democracy, and vice versa. So, National Registry of Citizens. The sociology lies in, it is an inclusion based on exclusion. I would put this way, exclusionary inclusion policy of the government. Exclusionary inclusion policy of the government. When you write something in opposites, it will be good. When you write something in opposites, it will be good. Exclusionary inclusion policy. What is exclusionary inclusion? Sociology is nothing but sociology of inclusion or exclusion. The entire sociology is nothing but inclusion exclusion binary. How many are included, how many are excluded? In every society, very few people are included and majority are excluded. Karl Marx has written about exclusion primarily economic in nature. Through the concept of class, he has explained economic exclusion. More and more exclusion in the economic realm is manifesting in multiple levels, and that is what is warranting a class conflict to make economic inclusion possible through classlessness. So, Marxism is about economic inclusion. Durkheim is about social inclusion. When he speaks about social solidarity, he writes about social inclusion. Parsons writes about social inclusion in the form of cultural inclusion and value generalization or value consensus. Max Weber writes about inclusion in the form of rationalization. So, entire sociology is about inclusion, and this concept of inclusion is a very, very dominant theme in the government policy or the government law. Now, there is a policy of the government to include the citizens who are only legal citizens and exclude others. There is a cutoff date given, March 25, 1971 cutoff date given, exclude all those people who came on or after March 25, 1971. So, you are including the inhabitants of Assam by excluding the people who do not have valid document. Doesn't mean that they are not the inhabitants. So, who and all are excluded? From this NRC, who and all are excluded? Sociology means marginalization. Who and all are excluded? Women are excluded. Transgenders are excluded. Minorities are excluded. Lesbians, gays are excluded. All these people are excluded. Women are excluded. How women are excluded? There is one study conducted by Azad. Azad study 2018. Azad in a study finds how women are excluded from NRC. How you know? If you wanted to get included, you produce the valid documents to prove your legacy. There is a legacy data which you have to prove, thereby you will get included in the NRC. So, documents, you should have the birth document or you should have the educational certificates so that you can get included in the NRC. But remember that most of the women will migrate due to marriage. They don't have any certificate to prove that they are the original inhabitants. And there is also present rampant child marriage. So, there is no certificate for the women. And when women went to the government and asked, we are left out, government told, don't worry, go to the panchayat, respective panchayat, you will get the certificate. Now, panchayat certificates are valid documents. You can go to the panchayat. If you don't have any birth certificate or educational certificates, you can go to the panchayat and get the certificate. Now, here also, after taking the panchayat certificate, you are going to the official to get yourself registered. Here, they are seeing whether you are a Muslim woman or you are a local inhabitant. if you are a Muslim woman, if you are a Hindu Bengali woman, the verification done by the state authority is very, very stringent verification. So there is a very stringent verification regime put in place for those women coming from religious minority group, Muslim women and Hindu women coming from West Bengal. So this is putting so much of stress on the minority women. There is an All Assam Transgender Association. There is an All Assam Transgender Association which is telling that 20,000 transgenders are present in Assam. 20,000 transgenders are present in Assam. Now these transgenders do not have any document again. Because when they are young, when they are children, they are thrown out of the family and they have no document to prove their lineage. There is no document to prove their lineage. So the transgenders are excluded from this NRC. Transgenders are excluded from the NRC. Rajkova study. RAJKHOVA Rajkova study in 2018 found how from the beginning Assam is having an ethnic problem. Historically, different ethnic communities have conflicts in Assam soil. So it is not inclusive society, rather historically Assam is an exclusive society because multiple ethnic groups are present from the beginning in Assam. So historically there is a process of exclusion witnessed by the different ethnic communities in Assam. They are excluded historically. Assam Accord 1985, according to Rajkova, is not a document made after getting the consensus opinion of the different communities. Assam Accord is not having any consensus amongst the different ethnic communities in Assam. So you cannot claim Assam Accord to be inclusive of all the ethnic communities. So historically Assam is exclusive and Assam Accord is not representing all ethnic communities. So based on Assam Accord, if you wanted to give legal guarantee, constitutional guarantee, safeguard for the culture of the Assam people for which you have gone for updation of NRC, this is not acceptable because the inclusion is not present. There was no consensus amongst the different ethnic groups in Assam regarding Assam Accord. Richardson study. Again, Richardson study found that how many tribes, religious minorities, women, transgenders, they are not given full citizenship. They are not given full citizenship. If citizenship means social, political, economic rights, if citizenship means social, political, economic rights, women were not accorded full citizenship, minorities were not given the social, political, economic rights, LGBTs were not given this social, political, economic rights. So citizenship is only partially given to these communities. There is no full-fledged citizenship. democracy wanted citizenship to be universally given to all. We have universal adult franchise under Article 326. So, citizenship should not be given in a discriminatory manner. Citizenship should be given to all equally, irrespective of which religion you practice, irrespective of which tribe you belong to, irrespective of what dialect you speak. Citizenship rights should be given to all equally. But Richardson found that citizenship right is not equally given to all. Only citizenship is given to those upper caste Hindu families. Full-fledged citizenship is given to upper caste Hindu family. Those families which resemble the upper caste Hindu family, these upper caste Hindu family resembling families are only given real citizenship. Others were not given full, they were given only partial citizenship. Bora, B-O-R-A, Bora study. What makes answer sociological is nothing but the name of the studies, Bora study. What Bora was telling, you know, from the beginning, we have not fully integrated the northeastern states with that of India. Only legal integration has taken place, but there is no psychic integration. So, therefore, northeastern states are kept backward. They are not having a full-fledged integration with the mainstream society. There is no full-fledged integration with the mainstream society. From the beginning, legal integration has taken place, but not emotional integration. And he is finding that this resulted in two-pronged approach by the state, two-pronged approach which is conflicting with each other. Two-pronged approach of the state is conflicting with each other. On one hand, the state says we wanted to include the Northeast India through democratic decentralization. For example, 6th schedule, 5th schedule, we wanted to give tribal governance to the people. We wanted to give tribal governance to the people. So, through constitutional methods, they wanted to resolve the problems of the Northeast Indian people through constitutional methods. This is one approach. Another approach is a very, very contradictory approach, a conflicting approach. That in that approach, we say that there is a policy of militarization which is practiced by the central government. Policy of militarization practiced by the central government. So, on one hand, the center is having a democratic approach, a constitutional approach. On another hand, extra constitutional approach to solve the problems of Northeast. For example, Armed Forces Special Power Act. So, you speak about the Aboriginal self-governance in Schedule 5, Schedule 6. You wanted to extend Forest Rights Acts to these scheduled tribes. But at the same time, and the number of products in the minor forest produce has got increased to 49. MSP is given to the MFC. MSP is given to MFC, minor forest produce. MSP is given to minor forest produce. All these things are happening in one side, but on the other hand, you are going tough up, you are going very tough with the northeastern people by extra constitutional methods and martial law like Armed Forces Special Power Act. So, this is quite confusing. Constitutional method, unconstitutional method, or extra constitutional method is used in a combined way. So, what is happening? This extra constitutional method will dilute or it will mitigate the benefits of the constitutional method. Kikon, K-I-K-O-N, Kikon.
he analyzes the British policy of the Northeastern tribes. The colonial discourse is that they presented Northeast India and mainstream India as binary. They presented Northeast India and mainstream India as binaries. How you know? By telling that Northeastern people belong to Mongolian type. So racially they divided Indian unity by creating a binary discourse with respect to Northeast India and the mainstream India. And this has resulted in the continuation of such binary construct even after independence. So resulting in mainstream Indian people given complete citizenship and Northeast Indian people given incomplete citizenship. So we follow the legacy of the colonial divide and rule policy. We followed the colonial discourse of binary construction of the Northeast as against the mainstream India. So mainstream India is given complete citizenship, whereas Northeastern India is given incomplete citizenship. So this type of exclusionary inclusion policy of the state. This type of exclusionary inclusion policy of the state for political gain has only resulted in reinforcement of the tribal conflicts. This type of exclusionary inclusive policy of the state for political gain has only resulted in the conflicts between the tribes in Northeast India. So tribal conflicts already present because it is a multi-tribal society. Already present multi-tribal society is again involving in more and more conflict with each other because of this exclusionary inclusion policy of the state for political gain. You know that it is more worse than caste conflict, tribal conflicts. Like two caste groups will involve in deadly fight with each other in caste-based India. Two tribes will involve in deadly fight with each other. So inter-tribal conflict got only reinforced because of this exclusionary inclusion policy of the state. Now what will happen? Those people who have exhausted all the legal remedies will have to be deported according to the state. You exhaust all the legal remedy and you have to be deported. How many people will be deported? Lakhs of people, 19 lakh people do not have their name in the list. 19 lakh excluded. So if suppose a million people were not able to prove their claim before the tribunal, foreigner tribunal, which will give you a judgment regarding whether you are a citizen or not. What will happen to this lakhs of tribal people? They will be deported. Deporting millions of people or lakhs of people, it is inhuman, first of all. It is inhuman. On one hand, it is also impractical on the other hand. Where you will tell these people to go? Deportation would result in inhuman conditions. Deportation on one hand is inhuman, on the other hand it is impractical. Because you have seen that the Rohingya Muslims from Myanmar, where they are going? They are going to Bangladesh. Are they living safely in Bangladesh? No. The last man in the humanity, according to the United Nations, they make a comment on this Rohingyas. You are the last man in the humanity. You are the last. you'll get lost soon. Submerged, you'll be submerged in humanity. So tribes who will be deported will become submerged in humanity. And therefore, it is impractical as well as it is inhuman. So already there is so much of sufferings which the tribal people are facing in Northeast India. So much of sufferings. And the sufferings will be more and more added because of this exclusionary policy. You are telling you have to prove your legacy. You have to look into the primordial claim of the people over land. You are giving a cutoff date and you are giving a binary opposite that you are inhabitant, you are not inhabitant. So all these exercises of deportation or the exercises of exclusions will add on to the already present problems of the tribes in Northeast India. Already tribes are losing their confidence in the constitutional methods. Their attachment towards constitution is lesser than the attachment of these tribes towards the monasteries. Now this exclusionary policies, the divisive rhetoric, the exclusionary divisive rhetoric of the state will add more problems to the already present plethora of problems of the tribes present in Northeast India. So what should be the basis of citizenship now? The basis of citizenship should not be state-centric. Citizenship should not be state-centric. Citizenship should be human-centric. Citizenship should not be state-centric. Citizenship should be human-centric. We have to create a civic identity. We have to create a civic identity which is consistent with the republican ideals of the constitution. We have to create a civic identity consistent with the republican ideal of the constitution. Right? So this should be the conclusion for citizenship related rights. They have asked citizenship and democracy. They have asked this question, citizenship and democracy. There was another question, T.H. Marshall's on citizenship and class. When they are asking a question on citizenship, whether it is paper 1 or paper 2, you can very well write NRC and citizenship. Citizenship Amendment Bill has done what? Those who conform to the Hindu social organization will be allowed. Those who are Muslims, disallowed. So from Afghanistan, Pakistan, Bangladesh, if you are a Muslim, you are not a citizen. With so much of uproar in the parliament today, it was passed. The opposition has torn the bill into pieces today. Today only it was passed or not? 311 votes it secured. Yesterday. It was torn into pieces. The bill text was taken by opposition. It was torn into pieces. Today it happened in the parliament. Understood? So, we have spoken about sociology of NRC. Now you should have understood that in the course of the lecture, I used some typical sociological words which has to be in the answer. You write your own statement, but use the divisive rhetoric, exclusionary inclusion, incomplete citizenship, binary construct of the British colonial discourse on the tribes. These are the words which will catapult your answer from this level to the next level. I have also told in the test batch that we are not here to write a mediocre answer. Anything less than 280 is equal to zero, because we have to write this examination again. Rather than getting 240-250, let us get zero, because anyhow we have to write the exam again if you get a 250 less. 280, 290, ideally 320. 320 can be done. People have done this, sitting in the same class, listening to the same lecture last year, people have done. So if they can do, why not you? Everybody is potential, according to me. I believe in this very strongly. Every single person sitting in this class is highly potential. But you have to unlock it. You have locked. Kindly unlock it and unleash your potential. For that, first you should believe that yes, I have potential. Understood? Good. Next topic is urbanization and tribes. So this is a topic which is there in paper 2, urbanization. Section C, there is a unit or there is a section called Section C in paper 2. In that they have given urbanization. In Section B, social structure, they have given tribes. So you can always expect a question linking Section B with Section C, because Section B is about social structure and Section C is about changing social structure. What is social structure? How the social structure is changing? Right? So the second topic is tribes and urbanization. Urbanization was kick-started even before independence during the British regime. Generally speaking, tribes will be residing in forest areas, in the rural areas. Now, what happened during the British period? During British administration, industrialization, urbanization, modern education was spread. So, substantial number of tribes living in the Northeast India were getting benefited because of this. Especially tribes present in Meghalaya. Meghalaya tribes were beneficiaries of the British administration, especially when British introduced modern education. They were the first to receive this modern education. They were becoming middle class. So middle class formation in tribes started during the British period, especially Meghalaya tribes. They went to modern education. They went to modern occupation. They went to towns. So tribal migration from rural forest areas to cities took place during the British period. However, whether tribes have become a part of the towns. No. Urbanization has taken place, but the tribes have not become the part and parcel of the towns. Why you know? That for British administration, there is a need for literate persons. There was no literacy among the tribal people. Modernization just now got kick-started by the British, and British wanted to run their administrative centers, for which they wanted literate people. So from where literate people came? From the plain area, literate people came to the tribal area. And these plain area people, after involving in administration, they were also involving in trade and commerce. So towns came in a big way because of the flourishing of the trade and commerce. Occasionally the tribes would go to the towns, but they could not become the part and parcel of the town economy because it was monopolized by only the caste groups. So this is a trend. Urbanization has resulted in migration of the tribes. If you look at the statistics, you will know how the percentage of tribal population and the total urban population consistently increased from 1961 onwards. 1961, only 1% of the tribal population was in urban regions. 1961, only 1% of the tribal population was in the urban centers. In 1981, it became 3%. In 2001, it became 7%. And 2011, it became 11%. So tribes in the urban places started increasing. 1% in 1961, 1% of the tribal population was in the city, but in 2011, 11% tribal population lived in the urban areas. A renowned author who studied tribal society called as Virginius Kaka, XAXA. Virginius Kaka. He found a trend. He says that urbanization of the tribes is very, very slow in the central India. Whereas urbanization of tribe in Northeast India is very phenomenal. So there is very less in Central India, Gujarat, Maharashtra. It's very less. Urbanization of tribe is very less. Very less tribal people went to cities. But in Northeast India, there is a fast-paced urbanization experienced by the tribes. For example, 3.5% of Gujarati tribes were present in urban areas, whereas 5% of Maharashtra tribes were present in urban areas. 5% of Madhya Pradesh tribes. So Madhya Pradesh tribes, 5% are in the urban areas. Whereas Gujarat, Maharashtra, only 3% of the 3 to 3.5% of the tribes were in the urban areas. But when you come to Northeast India, in case of Mizoram, 92% of the tribes of Mizoram, they are living in cities. They are living in the
urban regions. 92% of
Mizoram tribes are living in the urban places. Meghalaya, Nagaland, 70% of tribes were living in the urban places. Meghalaya and Nagaland, 70% of the tribes were living in the urban places. Whereas in case of Mizoram, 92% of the tribal people are present in the urban places, which means that urbanization of tribes in Northeast India is going at a very phenomenal rate compared to urbanization of tribes in the Central India or Western India. And this is a very important point which is worth exploring, because you have seen that urbanization alters social pattern of relation. What social pattern of relation will be altered because of urbanization? Tribal society is characterized by collectivism. Tribal society has collective ownership of land. They have community ownership of land. Because of urbanization, what is going to happen? Expressive orientation will transform to instrumental orientation. If you use Parsonian sociology, expressive orientation becomes now instrumental orientation. Expressive orientation, tribal societies are belonging to pattern variable A, according to Parsons. Now, because of urbanization, there is a pattern variable A changing to pattern variable B. Collectivism will be replaced by individualism. Magico-animistic religion will be replaced by great religion. You can see even in the Northeast India, especially the Meghalaya tribes, leaving magic, they started embracing different denominations of Christianity. Not just one denomination, they have entered into different denominations of Christianity. So a structural change is expected to be unfolded because of this urbanization of the tribes. They'll simply ask you, tribes and urbanization. Sociology is nothing but putting particular words in particular places. You know, sometimes we will not get the thread. When you read the question, that thread will not trigger in your mind, and which is the reason why we struggle to construct an answer. But once you have so many lines of arguments like this, so many themes when you go with, so many themes, tribes means this cultural type, citizenship means exclusion type, like that, when you develop so many themes, you see the question paper, read the question paper, now apply the themes which you had in sociology, definitely it will fit. So what was earlier something which is very different will become very easy for you when you approach the paper with so many themes. Third topic, Brahminical patriarchy.
There is a concept called as Brahminical patriarchy. Actually, this is very much present in early India, early Indian society, and this is also present in some traces are present in contemporary times. What are the indices of status of women? So you have some index based on which you say women have status low, women have status high. What are the indices of status? Indices of status. marriage rights, inheritance rights, ritual rights. These are some of the indices of women's status. Marriage rights, property rights, ritual rights. They are some of the indices of women's status. There is a structural framework which underlies gender inequality. So, what is the topic? Brahminical patriarchy. Where can you use this topic in your sociology syllabus? Unit number 5, social stratification, gender as the basis of stratification. Unit number 9, patriarchy and sexual division of labor. Unit number means paper 2, social change, section C, women's movement. Section C, social change, paper 2, violence against women. So, these are the places where you can use this stuff. There is present a structural framework underlying gender inequality, resulting in subordination of women to men. Women are getting subordinated to men because of gender inequality, which has a strong structural framework. So, this subordination of women is becoming more powerful due to religion. Why? There was a question which was asked in 2019 mains, whether all religions are patriarchal. Of course, feminism says all religions are patriarchal only. Whether it is Hinduism or Buddhism or Chinese religion or whatever, all religions are patriarchal according to feminist point of view. So, this subordination is becoming sharper because of what? Because of religion, because of rituals. A very, very important feature of Hindu social organization is extreme expression of social stratification. Hindu social organization has extreme expression of social stratification, which is having a very, very strong justification. Hindu social organization represents extreme expression of social stratification. If you write Hindu social organization is a stratification, it won't catch the attention of the examiner. Hindu social organization is an extreme expression of social stratification. In that social stratification of Hindu social organization, there are two primary stratification systems. One is caste-based stratification. Another is gender-based stratification. So, Hindu social organization manifests extreme expression of social stratification in two ways. One is gender-based stratification, another is caste-based stratification. So, the victims of this stratification are leading a life with indignity. Who are leading a life with indignity? The victims of this stratification system. Who are the victims of stratification system? lower caste and women. They are leading a life with indignity. They are leading a life with indignity, humiliation, and exploitation. Humiliation, exploitation, indignity. In Hinduism or Brahmanic Hinduism, what is very, very important is the notion of purity and impurity. This is very central to Brahmanical Hinduism, purity, impurity notion. Now, purity of caste is very much maintained. Purity of caste is very much maintained in this caste system. Purity of caste is maintained. So that is the core principle of caste system according to Louis Dumont. Purity pollution. Notion of purity pollution is very, very central to caste system in India according to Louis Dumont. So you can write this in the Louis Dumont as well. You can write in Louis Dumont also. There is one first unit or section A, perspectives, Indological perspective, Louis Dumont, they have given in caste system. They have given caste system, Louis Dumont. You can write about Louis Dumont and caste. You can use this stuff in that place, Louis Dumont on caste system. Purity pollution is a very, very strong notion present in the caste system. And this caste purity is maintained by two things. One is patrilineal inheritance. Another is chastity of women. So the honor of the caste system is contingent on the purity of women. Now, purity is in terms of chastity of women. Chastity of women means control over female sexuality. It means control over female sexuality. So, caste purity needed control over female sexuality on one hand and patrilineal inheritance on the other hand. So you can see that these three things are present like a trinity. Caste purity, female sexuality controlled by men, and thirdly, property inheritance. Gerda Lerner. Writes about Mesopotamian civilization. Gerda Lerner studied Mesopotamian civilization. Gerda Lerner found that in this Mesopotamian civilization, some women were having high status, some women are having low status. Some women were having high status. For example, they are rich women. Some women are having low status because they are poor women. So, status differences existed amongst women. But whatever may be your status, women's sexuality was controlled by men. Whatever may be the status, high status women, low status women, both are present in Mesopotamia. But irrespective of the status, women's sexuality was controlled by men. Which means that economic independence is not liberating women from patriarchal control. Economic independence has not liberated women from patriarchal control. So rich women are controlled by men, so as poor women are controlled by men. This subordination of women is
caste because of caste, patriarchy, class, and state action. So caste is influencing women's status. Class is influencing women's status. Patriarchy influences women's status. State action also influences women's status. Noor Yalman study of Malabar and Ceylon. N-U-R, Noor Yalman, Y-A-L-M-A-N. N-U-R, Noor, Y-A-L-M-A-N, Noor Yalman study of Ceylon and Malabar, found that three things are very much reinforcing each other. Number one, land. Number two, women. Number three, rituals. All the three structures are very much interconnected to each other. Land, women, ritual are very much interconnected with each other. So, female sexuality is controlled by controlling land. Female sexuality is controlled by controlling religion. Therefore, women, land, and rituals are three structures which are reinforcing each other according to Yalman's study. So, which means that this is giving you a very important insight. The insight is that without women having access to religion, female sexuality will be very much controlled by patriarchy. And in this context, you should think about Sabarimala verdict. Religion is a very, very important, powerful instrument of controlling women. Through religion, women were controlled from the times of Mesopotamian civilization. Through religion, women were controlled. So, when you speak about Sabarimala temple, when you celebrate the Supreme Court judgment last year, which allowed women to enter Sabarimala temple, it is not just a question of temple entry. It is a question of equality. It is not just a question of women entry, temple entry. It is a question of equality. And now when property rights are given to women by amending the act, women are equal legal heir along with their brothers to the father's property. This is again a structural change which they have introduced. Because through property and religion, women were kept perpetually subordinated to men. When property rights are given to women, when right to enter the religious places is given to women, it cannot be simply seen as a piece of legislation when women were given property rights. It cannot be simply seen as a Supreme Court judgment by reinforcing women's right to religion. Rather, it is a structural change which we are effecting through these judicial interpretations and legislation. Structural change. So, two things you have to do. Give property right to women, and secondly, right to religion should be given to women. Because this extreme expression of social stratification will go off, at least will get diluted, if not mitigated, it gets diluted. Annihilation of caste, Dr. Ambedkar says. How can caste become annihilated let caste not influence your liberty. If you don't allow caste to influence your liberty, caste will go. Because caste-based inequality is a very, very stronger form of inequality than racial inequality. In 1960, because of the black movement, because of the emergence of some literature supporting blacks, black feminism came as a different branch, as a sub-branch of feminism. Black feminism came supporting the plights of the black women. Caste is not getting signed out. It is not signing out. We'll also discuss about should caste-based reservation continue? Can we have another basis of reservation? Forget about caste. Let us have class-based reservation. And that was affected by this 103rd Amendment Act, economically backward. So many things are there with the help of which we can analyze. Perspectives are there in sociology with the help of which we can analyze things. Next, blasphemy. BLASPHEMY, blasphemy. What do you mean by this blasphemy? Blasphemy an antithesis of secularism. Blasphemy, next topic is blasphemy, an antithesis of secularism. What do you mean by this word blasphemy? Speaking evil of divine things. Speaking evil of divine things is called as blasphemy. Speaking evil of divine things is called as blasphemy. We should understand the Constituent Assembly debate about secularism. The members were divided about what type of secularism we have to adopt in the Constitution. So, Constituent Assembly got divided into two groups. One wanted French model of secularism. 2019 mains question. One group wanted French model of secularism. The other group wanted Indian model of secularism. The same question was asked. How many times they will ask this question? 3-4 times. I think 3 times they have asked in the 6-7 years. So, a group of people like K.T. Shah and some under K.M. Munshi, they were involving in a big debate. K.T. Shah and others were telling, let us have French model, which means state and religion are completely exclusive of each other. Mutual exclusion.
no connection whatever, whatsoever will be between the state and religion, no connection at all. State and religion will not have any connection at all. I am purely autonomous. I am purely independent of you. So you don't come in my way, I will not come in your way. And that is what the mutual exclusion practiced in the French model. But this won't suit Indian context according to some people like K. Munshi, and these people prevailed. So this Indian model says right to freedom of conscience will have to be given, Article 25 to 28. Derogatory practices in the name of religion should be curbed. No derogatory practices in the name of religion. All will have equal right to religion. No derogatory practices in the name of religion. And most importantly, Indian type of secularism is based on reformative approach. For example, Article 25, Clause 2, Subclass A, Article 25, Clause 2, Subclass B, especially provides for social reform. State has to provide for social reform by throwing open Hindu temples of public character to all sections of Hindus, is what the text of 25.2b. So we have incorporated Indian secularism, which gives importance to reformative approach. Blasphemy law in India is section 295A of Indian Penal Code, IPC. This IPC section 295A was incorporated in early 20s when there was communal conflict taking place, especially in places like Punjab. There was a competitive communalism in Punjab. So early 20s, there was competitive communalism, and there was a big law and order problem because of communalism. So therefore, to restore law and order, IPC section 295A was incorporated. What IPC section 295A says? It says that if you are insulting the religious sentiments of people with a deliberate malicious intention, if you are insulting the religious sentiments of people or religion, if you are insulting a religion or religious sentiment of the people deliberately with a malicious intention, it is an offense. Now, what is the problem? 295A, let it be there, because there is a law and order problem. You have to have this provision. Maybe an argument, but actually speaking, why the law came and how the law is applied, these are two different things. Law came to restore law and order because there was competitive communalism. Hindu versus non-Hindu, in a competitive way, they are spreading communal hatredness. They are competing with each other to spread communal hatredness, law and order problem. So therefore, 295A says, anyone who insults the religious sentiments of people with a malicious intention will be punished, will be jailed. But problem is this. The problem is that any law, the intention of the making may not be doubted more. So there may not be any substantive criticism against the law, but how the law is applied by judiciary, how the law is extended by the state machinery. It is used by judiciary or used, applied by the state machinery in such a way to silence criticism against religion. Silencing criticism against religion is not secular. 295A interferes with two things. One is, it interferes with social reform.
it is interfering with social reform. Number two, it interferes with the freedom of atheists and non-believers. So blasphemy law or section 295A interferes with two things. One is it interferes with the social reform. Because without criticizing religion, how can you reform religion? Yes or no? Without criticizing religion, how will you reform religion? So it interferes with the religious reform. Secondly, it interferes with the freedom of the atheist and the non-believers. So the non-believer, if he says that God is not existing, he will be arrested under 295A. Silencing the criticism is anti-secular. Silencing criticism is anti-secular. Criticism against religion shall not be construed as blasphemy. We cannot construe criticism of religion as blasphemy. But actually what is done is, when somebody criticizes a religion, to reform the religion, they were silenced, they were jailed. So religious fanaticism is only encouraged by 295A. Religious fanaticism is encouraged by 295A. Silencing the criticism of the non-believers and atheists. We have a long history of atheist. We had a long history of atheist. How atheist came in the first place? Who came first? Atheist came first or theist came first? Theist came first. Criticizing the theist came atheist. So atheist, we have a long history of atheist. That Sankhya philosophy in the ancient tradition. Charvaka philosophy in the ancient tradition, Sankhya philosophy in ancient tradition, including Buddhism, came as a criticism of Hinduism. Charvaka, Sankhya, Buddhism, they all questioned religion and the inequality promoted by religion, justified by religion. Inequality promoted, justified by religion was questioned by Sankhya philosophy, questioned by Charvaka as well as Buddhism. In the ancient time, in the modern times, you have people like Periyar, Dr. Ambedkar, Bhagat Singh, Ram Manohar Lohia, a number of individuals came to question the inequality promoted in the name of religion, justified in the name of religion. Religion in a secular society requires criticism constructively. There has to be a constructive criticism of religion in a secular society. Supreme Court has said in St. Xavier College versus State of Gujarat case.
Supreme Court in this case, St. Xavier College versus State of Gujarat State, says secularism means not no God. Secularism is not meaning no God. It is not meaning anti-God. It means that a theist, the devout,
the theist and the agnostic will be treated alike.
Secularism means what? The devote, the theist, and an agnostic. All will be treated alike. That is what is the meaning of secularism. A devout person, very religious person, an theist, an atheist person who believes that there is no God, and an agnostic person who tries to see religion in a scientific way. Neither believing in religion nor disbelieving in religion is agnostic. So one who believes in religion called devout, one who disbelieves in religion called atheist, one who has no belief nor disbelief about religion called agnostic, all the three will be treated alike. That is what is real secularism according to Supreme Court. So what is done is that through this section 295, we deny the right which constitutionally is guaranteed to these two people. Because freedom of conscience means what? I have my right to mold my own belief system. I don't believe. That itself is a belief. I believe not to believe. So I have every freedom to mold my belief system. I will agree, I will disagree, I will not accept, I will accept. If I don't accept, then I will criticize, and that criticism is needed for the social reform. Without criticizing, religion cannot reform. So engagement with religion requires constructive criticism. Engagement with religion requires constructive criticism. Therefore, blasphemy law violates constitutional secularism. Blasphemy law violates constitutional secularism. We should remember that in Constituent Assembly, when they wanted to move this objective resolution, some members suggested that we have to add these words, in the name of God. Some members told in the name of God, which was rejected by all the members. Other members totally rejected it. How can you say in the name of God, we are secular? Dr. Ambedkar was asked this question, why didn't you say secular in the preamble? He said that it is very much present in part 3, then why should I say? Only by 76th Amendment Act they brought this secular, and now they wanted to remove it. Today they will not remove it. It will be reserved after some time because you have so many issues to tackle. So what is the topic? Blasphemy, an antithesis of secularism, where you will write religion and society, 8th unit, secularism. Similarly, secularism in India, paper 2. Now next topic is caste and castelessness. I told you that exclusionary inclusion, something which is opposites, will attract always the imagination of the question setter. Syllabus, you see, equality and inequality. 5th unit, paper 1C, equality and inequality. Why you wanted equality? Because there is equality. So this is an article written by a sociologist. His name is Satish Deshpande. He has written this article, Caste and Castelessness. Indian society is divided into two unequal sections. There are two sections in India. Section 1 wanted caste, and section 2 don't want caste. So this is nothing but a representation of two different sections who are unequal in India. One wanted caste system to continue, another do not want caste system. So we spoke about caste and castelessness. This is a section present in the Indian society who wanted caste to be present, because based on the caste they can make claims on the state. So they can make claims from the state. For example, they can ask for caste based reservation. And they also wanted to practice this caste based politics, identity politics. So caste based politics, identity politics, caste based reservation will have to be supported by this group. There is another group who don't want caste to continue in Indian society. They say that we have to move away from caste system towards class based stratification. They wanted to move away from caste based stratification to class based stratification. They wanted modernization to happen in India. They supported this process of modernization. So employment will be a modern employment, urban living, secular education, and when you practice this, caste will not be a matter of present, caste will become history. So it will become a history, it will become a matter of past. But we should understand that those who claim that there should be castelessness, they are the beneficiaries of modernization. They are the beneficiaries of modernization. So they extract all the benefits of modernization, and they thereafter say there is no need for caste. So there is a process of naturalization of the upper caste, extracting all the benefits of modernization. There is a process of naturalization of the upper caste, extracting the benefits of modernization. After getting the benefits of modernization, they say that caste should not be present. So caste should not be present in the public place. Caste should not be an indicator of, caste should not be a criteria for reservation policy. Caste should not influence whom should be married by us, whom should not be married by us. Caste should not influence the opportunities given to people. So they prefer this term called as castelessness. But we know that those who benefited because of modernization, they have taken up the identity which is based on achievement. They have taken up a profession, and that professional identity has been written over their traditional identity. So modern identity has replaced their traditional identity. Modern identity has replaced their traditional identity, and therefore modernity enabled them to go for castelessness. modernity enabled them to leave their traditional identity and go for castelessness.
But this is not there for the disprivileged section, whose caste identity is getting strengthened because modernization has not given them any benefit. So one who has benefited from modernization, they have taken up the modern achievement based identity, and one who is not a beneficiary of modernization, they have to retain their old identity to explain, to express the exclusion which they were experiencing for such a long period of time. So identity has been taken up by them to tell to the state that they have been at the receiving end for a very long period of time. Therefore, we have seen these two sections. One, easily changing their identity for another group, the primordial identity has become indelible. It cannot be deleted. It has become indelible. And they use this identity to ask from the state concessions like reservation. They try to become a political force by making caste-based political formulations. So that shows the emergence of Dalit consciousness. Dalits are emerging as an assertive identity today. So this is the thing which we have to understand, that those beneficiaries, they say there is no need for caste, and those who are still victim present in the tradition, in the present, like that of the past, they wanted their identity to be more and more reinforced, to ask for concession from the state. So the beneficiaries of modernity have monopolized a category called as general category. So they have become general category. General category means what? Caste has become no more present. There is a castelessness in the general category. You come under general category. So you are not going to show your caste. So general category has been monopolized by the beneficiaries of modernization. So there are two such sections. One wanted caste to stay, another wanted caste to go. So castelessness, according to Satish Deshpande, is a myth. It is a myth. You cannot get relieved from the caste because this society was founded based on the caste for thousands of years. But the newly gotten identity which has been taken up, because of modernization, has made these groups, small number of groups, to say that we have become modern, we have moved to class-based society, and the society has changed from ascriptive to achievement. But majority of the society is still living in the world of caste. Caste is getting reinforced through worship. Caste is reinforced through work. So work and worship reinforces caste. That is why even today, most of the administrators are belonging to Kshatriya Varna. Many college teachers belongs to Brahmin category, Brahmin Varna, and the traders are Vaishyas. Those who are doing the menial job, they are only Shudras. Those who are involved in the manual scavenging, 100% of them belong to the untouchable caste of the past. Out of 10 billionaires in India, 9 came from Vaishya origin. So caste is influencing your work, caste is influencing your worship, and therefore only for few people who claim that there is no caste at all, it's just a myth. It's only a rhetoric
it's just a rhetoric, it is not real. And that is the viewpoint of Satish Deshpande. Understood. So, caste and castelessness, where you have to write this, you can write this in Modernization of Indian Tradition, paper 2. You can write this in caste structure or social structure, section B. There is one topic called caste system. You can write this. You can write this in the Modernization of Indian Tradition. You can write this in caste conflict also. In paper 2, last unit is caste conflict. You can write that. And you can also write this in the Emerging Dalit Consciousness. There is a topic which is a very, very famous topic which is repeatedly asked, Dalit Consciousness. Right? So, next topic is aging.
This is very well present in your syllabus.
Paper 2, there is a topic called as aging. Sociology of aging. There are some structural changes which took place in Indian society because of which the proportion of aged population has increased. In the total population, the proportion of aged population has increased because of some structural changes. We can say that there is a family change which is taking place in India. So, there is a family structural change. Family structure is changing from joint to nuclear. Migration from rural area to urban area, then informalization of economy. So, these are some of the changes taking place, and without we promising healthy aging, without ensuring active and healthy aging, we will not be able to realize our demographic potential. Without promoting healthy aging, active aging, we cannot tap the demographic dividend present. We cannot tap the demographic dividend. So, realizing the demographic dividend is a distant reality. If we are failing to invest in the aged. So, the changes are taking place and there is a proportion of the aged population increasing. From 1990 to 2000, economic changes, medical changes have taken place. Life expectancy has got increased because of the medical advancement. Industrialization, medical advancement has increased the lifespan. By 2030, UN says by 2030, there will be 1.4 billion aged people. By 2030, there will be 1.4 billion aged people. Which will be more than the population below 15 years of age. So, 2030, how many people will be below 15 years of age? 1.3 billion. How many people will be 60 plus? 1.4 billion. And by 2050, the old age population will be outnumbering youth population and children, adolescent population. By 2050,
old population will outnumber youth population and adolescent population. If you look at this concept of doubling time means what? How much time takes for a population to double in terms of numbers? So doubling time is related to doubling of the size of the population. It took 110 years for France to double its population, old age population. So it took 110 years, before 110 years, the total old age population out of total population is only 7%. It was only 7%. But it became 14% in 110 years. To double the old age population, Germany takes only 80 years. To double the old age population, China takes 25 years. And to double the old age population, India takes only 20 years. So in 20 years time, India's old age population will double. From 6%, it has become today 12%. Soon it is going to become 12% and it may even cross 20% in the days to come. So now when population, aged population is doubling, what is the need of the time? Social security. Social security is needed to tackle the social risk which they have. Sickness, unemployment, social exclusion. Sickness, unemployment, social exclusion. These are the social risk which will be faced by the older people. And therefore, we have to invest in the geriatric care. Actually speaking, geriatric care is very much ignored in India. In West and all, you have proper geriatric care. Elderly people will have a proper care. But in India, geriatric care is neglected. And look at this labor market. What is the role of the aged now? The role, social role of the aged has got changed. Economic role of the aged people have got changed because of their physical capacity changes. Economic role, social role of the aged people have gone for changes. So they don't have opportunities in the job market today because the labor market is completely outnumbered by the youths. So youths are more in the labor market and therefore the aged people may not be preferred. Hence there is a change in their economic role, there is a change in their social role. If you see, there are 34 crore aged people in India, which is more than the population of US. This is a prediction by 2050. By 2050, there will be 34 crore 60 plus of age, which will be more than the US population. So 20% of the total population will be 60 plus by 2050. 20% of the total population will be aged population by 2050. And you can see this from 2000 to 2050. From 2000 to 2050, in 50 year time, total population will increase by 56%. From 2000 to 2050, total population will increase by 56%. 60 plus will increase by 326%. 60 plus will increase by 326% and 80 plus will increase by 700%. So in the 50 year time, from 2000 to 2050, total population will increase by 56%. Aged 60 plus will increase by 326%. And 80 plus will increase by 700%.
you look at the vulnerability of the aged people. There is a vulnerability of the aged people because of the family structure changing. Joint family gave you the social security, economic security, but nuclear family promoted by individualism is not giving them security, leading to the mushrooming of the age-old homes. Age-old home is mushrooming today, because joint family has been replaced by nuclear family. In the cities, the elderly people are getting the care and attention only from the maids who were employed by them. So the family members are not taking care of the elderly in the city. It is the paid people who are taking care of the elderly people. So the vulnerability of the aged people in city is more than that of rural area, because in rural places there is present some joint family setup which will take care of the elderly people. 85% of the elderly people told that they are economically dependent on others. So they see themselves as an economic burden to the family. 40% of them say that they are not leading a happy life. 40% of the elderly people say they are not leading a happy life. 85% of the elderly are economically dependent on the other members of the family. So they say that they are an economic burden to the family. There is inaccessible healthcare system, inadequate healthcare system, geriatric care is excluded or ignored in India. So this brings to the point that there is so much of social investment, human development investment, or human capital investment which has to be made by the state today. Right? So this is about aging. And globalization and aging, there was a question which was asked in general studies paper, I think, in GS paper 1, they have asked about globalization and aging. Actually, this is nothing but the topic which we have discussed is nothing but globalization and aging only. Globalization has resulted in informal economy, globalization has resulted in nuclear family, urbanization, professional workers who will take care of the maids, who will take care of the elderly people, old age homes are mushrooming. All these are the impacts of globalization. Next topic is human development. Human development. Concept of human development was written way back by philosophers like Aristotle and Immanuel Kant. From those days, this is a very important topic. Aristotle, Immanuel Kant spoke about human development. Human development approach includes, number one, human freedom and dignity. Number two, active human agency. Human freedom. Because expansion of freedom is the primary goal of human development according to Amartya Sen. Expansion of human freedom is the primary goal of human development according to Amartya Sen. He is using a term, unfreedoms. We have been experiencing unfreedoms. This word is very much used by Amartya Sen, unfreedoms. So caste is not giving you the freedom to choose your occupation. So caste is causing unfreedom. Gender is restricting the realization of potential of women. Gender is restricting the realization of potential of women. So gender is
causing unfreedom. We have to free ourselves. Human development means freedom. Human development means expansion of freedom. Human development means promotion of human dignity. Human development means active role should be given to the individual. For example, in Bangladesh, there was a successful microfinance model called as Grameen Bank. This was based on the agency, active agency. It was based on the principle of active agency. Agency here means individual. So the structure is what is the underlying social pattern, and there is an agency called as individual. Now, if individuals can activate themselves, if the individual agency can activate themselves, they can change the structure itself. Therefore, Mahatma Gandhi says, the change which you wanted to see in the world will have to start from you. Be the change you wanted to see in others. Gandhi speaks about individual dignity, individual freedom. So, human development requires a multi-dimensional approach to study the well-being of the people. GDP is not important. National income is not important. Well-being is very important. Bhutan has come out with gross national happiness. So, happiness is very important. In Bhutan constitution, it is written that 80% of the tree cover will have to be present in Bhutan. So, Bhutan constitution itself speaks about how nature and man should lead a harmonious life. So, that is development. Growth is not development, Amartya Sen says. Growth is not development. Growth alongside, if present, inequality and poverty, then that is no development at all. Because growth will not guarantee eradication of poverty. Growth will not guarantee eradication of inequality. So, it is a possibility that alongside growth, inequality and poverty may also rise. Therefore, Amartya Sen says, the demand of development is beyond the demand of growth. So, developmental demand is going beyond the demand of growth. Growth is only a means. Development only is the end. Way back in 2010, Amartya Sen has wanted a multidimensional approach, and that is the time period because of Amartya Sen and others. UNDP came out with multidimensional poverty index. Poverty shall not be calculated based on income. Poverty should be based on non-economic criteria. And this concept you have to link with what? Poverty and social exclusion present in unit number 5. Link this with the unit number 5, poverty and social exclusion. Peter Townsend speaks about deprivation index. So, deprivations are relative, not absolute. Gross national income or GDP is based on statistics taken from the consumption of people of the commodities given in the commodity basket. How much they can consume, those commodities kept in the commodity basket. But this is not capturing the deprivation, which is a broader concept than poverty. Development is a counter current to deprivation. So, only through development, deprivation can end. For development, we have to focus on
redistributive ethos. Number one, redistributive ethos. Number two, sustainable investment. Number two, sustainable investment. And number three, integrated framework for synergies. Integrated framework for synergies means what? No policy should be isolated from other policies. So you should have a policy framework which is interconnecting all the developmental indicators. Education shall not be taken separate from that of sanitation. Sanitation cannot be separately dealt than that of poverty reduction. Employment generation should not be separately constructed than that of housing. So, housing, sanitation, drinking water, habitation, poverty reduction, education, health facility, all will have to be integrated. So, when you integrate, you will get a synergy. Developmental approach says, public policy alone will not bring the desired result. You cannot simply expect the public policy to do magic. Community-based approach, along with public policy, alone can bring development. Community-based approach along with public policy alone can bring development. Some developing countries have gone for certain models. Some developing countries have gone for some models. For example, in Brazil, in 1980s, they went for a social program, a social security program called as Bolsa Familia. Through this Bolsa Familia model of Brazil, they invested more on education, health than on defense. So look at, in India also we had Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act. In Brazil, through this Bolsa Familia, they gave conditional transfer of cash, conditional cash transfer. So, cash transfer cannot replace the social security programs. Social sector schemes cannot be replaced by cash transfer. For example, the government is spending, say, 46,000 crore for rural employment guarantee program. You cannot simply, without rolling out the program, identify the beneficiary and deposit the money in their bank account. Keep quiet. Conditional cash transfer is only supplementing the social security program. Amartya Sen says you cannot replace social security program by cash transfers. And Brazil has done that, not as a replacement to social security program. Along with social security program, conditional cash transfers were given. Because there was a talk going on in India that when you launch a program, there is so much of bureaucratic red tapeism, and you are not able to spend all the money to the poor people. When it goes, there is so much of pilferages, leakages. So why don't we directly put the money in the bank account of those people? We have given the bank account through Jan Dhan Yojana. We have created a bank account for all. Why don't we put money in that? But actually speaking, Amartya Sen is totally against this, that you cannot replace the social security programs. It has to be supplemented by conditional cash transfer, as is the case of Brazil. So developing countries have come out with some developmental frameworks. What development will have to capture is not just inequality of outcome, development will capture inequality of opportunity also. So you cannot basically capture only inequality of outcome. First, you have to capture inequality of opportunity.
inequality of opportunity will have to be captured, not just inequality of outcome. So Amartya Sen is using a term. We have to identify the comprehensive outcome, not the cumulative outcome, he says. We have to capture the comprehensive outcome, not the cumulative outcome. So the success of the program should not be based on how much money the government spends. Outcome should not be based on how much money the government spent on the program. Outcome should be based on how many people were really benefited by the program, human development programs. And now that we also see poverty is more present amongst the women in all caste groups. A poor woman is more poor than a poor man belonging to the same family. A poor woman is more poor than a poor man belonging to the same family, which means there is a gender dimension to poverty and inequality. For example, a Dalit girl child wanted to pursue medical course. See how many obstacles she is going to face. One, she is not going to have a proper schooling. So inadequate schooling will be present. Number one. Number two, there is a social indifference. There is a indifference in the social attitude. The entire society is not so much bothered about this Dalit girl who wanted to study medicine. There is a social indifference. Right? Society is not caring about this girl. And thirdly, in her own family, she'll have problems. So family will not prefer this girl to go to school. Society is indifferent to the dreams of this girl. And there is no adequate schooling for this girl. So she has to suffer from these three types of deprivations if she wanted to pursue a medical course. Poor people, women are facing so many social shocks. They are facing so many social shocks. Cultural shock. Macroeconomic shock, health shock. They are more vulnerable for all shocks. Social shock, cultural shock, economic shock, political shock. And what happens when there is an environmental degradation? Millions of poor people are dependent on environment for their livelihood. And that environmental degradation caused by global warming is playing havoc in the life of the poor people. So environmental problem or environmental degradation is having a more grave bearing on the life of the poor tribes because they are dependent on the environment. So any social policy will have to involve community participation. So economic development, environmental sustainability programs will have to involve the vulnerable sections. So economic and social sustainability will have to be the priority. Economic and social sustainability will have to be the priority. For that, you wanted not just a local framework, a global framework for inclusive development is needed today. A global framework for inclusive development is need of the time today. So this is about human development, and where you can use this is unit number 5, poverty you can use. Similarly, in the 7th chapter of section C, social changes, in paper 2, you can use. Environmental sustainability, environmental problem, sustainable development. There is one topic given in the 7th unit of section C. Challenges during social transformation. Challenges during social transformation. So that is the 7th unit which we have to study. Understood? So this is about human development. And a related topic, 8th topic, is multidimensional poverty index. Some data you need to know. MPI, because UNDP came out with 2019 report on multidimensional poverty index. And what is happy for India is India has improved its standing. In fact, multidimensional poverty reduced by 50% in India. So MPI poors have got reduced by 50% in India. Maximum reduction happened in Jharkhand. And this is a good story. Maximum reduction of multidimensional poors have taken place in Jharkhand. But still, there are four states which account for 196 million multidimensional poors. 196 multidimensional poors are coming from four states like Bihar, Jharkhand, UP, MP. Bihar, Jharkhand, UP, MP houses 196 million multidimensional poors. The trend says that 80% of STs were suffering from MP, were MPI poors. 80% of STs were MPI poors in 2005-06. But it reduced to 50% in 2015-16. So MPI poors among scheduled tribes and Muslims have been reduced. It is a very good trend. MPI poors amongst Muslims and STs have reduced. 2005-06, MPI poors among STs have been 80%. So 80% of scheduled tribes were MPI poors in 2005-06. It has reduced to 50% in 2015-16, 10-year time. Similarly, 91% of total population felt deprivation in 2005-06, 91% of the total population of India felt deprivation, one or the other form of deprivation, and that reduced to 82% in 2015-16. So from 91%, deprivation reduced to 82%. Alirajpur in Madhya Pradesh has maximum MPI poors. Alirajpur, Madhya Pradesh has maximum MPI poors, that is 76%. So the trend is this, that the number of MPI poors, especially STs and minorities, Muslims, have reduced. So this is a good trend. But at the same time, still four states, Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, Jharkhand and Maharashtra, it accounted for 196 million MPI poors. So multidimensional poverty index report was published by UNDP in 2019. And where we can write this is again social exclusion. So it is not, what is important to be studied under MPI is, it is not based on economic poverty, it is based on social exclusion, deprivation in other aspects. For example, housing, what is the toilet availability in the house, electricity, type of fuel we are using, type of the floor we are having, cooking gas we are accessing, right? So all these things are counted in the MPI. There are 10 indicators based on access to services, not based on per capita consumption expenditure. unlike the previous estimation, which is based on per capita consumption expenditure. It is based on deprivation in the services. So this is what is social exclusion actually. Social exclusion study is broader than the poverty study. And this question has been asked many times. Social exclusion is a broader concept than poverty. Poverty captures only economic inequality, whereas social exclusion captures non-economic inequality like deprivations at multiple levels. So a deprivation index was constructed by Peter Townsend in Britain in 1970s, where he constructed a deprivation index consisting of 60 parameters. Like if you cannot go to attend a birthday party, if you cannot go to vacation, if you cannot go to your friend's place, if nobody has come to your place in the last 1 week, you are poor according to MPI or deprivation index. So this data can be connected to social exclusion. Since time is due to the right in between, there was some sort of chaotic environment, right? It's nice to see that people implement law of the land with the utmost respect. So constitution will long very it will have a very longer life because of the system in place. Anyhow, right, so see you in the next class. What I am expecting from your end is, if you could write 1 or 2 points extra than what you know as of before, that is the testimony of the success. Extra, what extra you are going to make in your score, this is what is the extra. So see you in the next class. We'll give you the message related to the current affairs sociology class, and kindly follow the Telegram channel, because daily basis, not even a single day we have missed, we are putting for you only highlighted portion. Just take a note of it and revise it many times. Thank you, all the best.